name is Sharon Sacon. I was one of the project creators of Shouting from the Margins, Black Orange County, 1960 to 1979. I'm the director of the Studio for Southern California History. It's a nonprofit dedicated to critically chronicling and sharing the region's social history in order to foster a sense of place. That's a long mission statement, but it's basically teaching you to respect where you live and ask common sense questions about its history. I'm also a former instructor here. I taught in the Honors Program, American Studies, and in Ethnic Studies.
And I'm Joe Zavala. I call myself an assistant to this project, but Chair would have me call you, but would call me co-author instead, so try to adjust to that. I basically just helped any kind of interviews, helping this exhibit put together. That's my role in this project. I was a student here. I graduated back in 2020 with my bachelor's in history at CSUF. And it's just been a fun road ever since.
So this exhibit started from our research project, which was inspired by Harlen Lambert and Daniel Michael Lynem. I met those gentlemen about 15 years ago through different projects in Santa Ana. And I followed both of them and followed how their histories were being gathered, and I didn't like the lack of attention they were getting. I felt that academics, the local press, everybody should care about these individuals because of the kind of sacrifices they've made for democracy in our country. Harlen Lambert was the first Black police officer hired by Santa Ana in 1967. He left in 1973. And at the same time, you have Daniel Michael Lynem, who is the head of the Black Panther Party in Santa Ana. At the time, they were natural enemies, but in my friendship with them, I saw them develop their own relationship. And at one point, Daniel asked Harlen for forgiveness for misunderstanding who he was during the 1960s, and Harlen immediately gave it. That expression of forgiveness and gratitude both ways was something I was incredibly moved by. I don't believe many historians get to witness that. And it was very humbling. And I kept thinking about all the people in between them on that political continuum. Here you have the far left with the Black Panther Party, and then you have the right with a police officer. And I kept thinking about all the people in between who weren't politically active, who maybe were liberal or were moderate, weren't on the far end of either one, and how they gave back to the community in ways that weren't described as political, but were. So we did a lot of newspaper sweeps. We asked for referrals from people we interviewed, people we should interview, and we were very, very lucky to get lots of referrals. We were able to interview Jules, Farquhar, who was the first Black school teacher, elementary school teacher in Fullerton. Her husband was a Tuskegee Airman. And we interviewed a lot of other firsts and leaders. But we also interviewed mothers, artists, theater people who used their medium, their tools to advocate for change, for equality, for fairness, for diversity, and multiculturalism in ways that maintain the character of each person. And it was really a difficult project to do under COVID. But I have to say, it was incredibly rewarding. As all of the history projects I engage in are, they teach me far more than I ever expect to learn. And at this time in our American history, I think it's really important to acknowledge all of the people who contribute to creating a great nation and to study them, because they were able to achieve different forms of equity and agency in really hard times in the 60s and 70s. We again are facing those times, and their methods may be something we can learn from.
One of the key things I learned, like at least from a historian's perspective, is the ways the national histories are embodied in the smaller scale within towns, within counties, within sections of the state. Because in California, sometimes we can feel kind of disembodied from what's going on from the rest of the country. Especially in terms of the civil rights movement, where we think of the Deep South, where we think of New York, we think of the East end of the country, where we have plenty of clear examples of it happening right here in front of us. One of the interviews I did with Daniel, he said, the people in Orange County, they didn't have Jim Crow, but they wanted it really badly, which I think symbolizes kind of what the whole environment of what was going on in Orange County at the time, how the kind of zeitgeist of the era. On a more personal level, from all the interviews I've done and from what I've heard, the importance of sticking to one's values is one lesson that sticks out for me, because of all the interviews, almost everybody has at least some form of going through their life and not betraying their own values, of sticking with them, and of those values, helping them get out of situations or improving their lives or improving the lives of people around them.
The exhibit is in the Pollak Library, and it's literally in this really beautiful, intimate space, and it's such a, you know, honor and opportunity to be able to share the work here. It has a brief introduction to talk about the inspiration behind it and some of the key people who are part of the exhibit. All of the key people who are part of the exhibit are in little frames that you'll see, and the images within the frames are from the 1960s or 1970s. Over here you'll see an inset from the Daily Titan, which I think is amazing. It's from 1968, and students at the time dedicated an inset of the Daily Titan to discuss housing discrimination, racial inequality, and discrimination in general on campus and in Fullerton. And it's a piece of history that many people can study. It not only lists addresses, but people who advocate for them, the kinds of discrimination they felt just going to the grocery store, as well as how they were able to purchase housing or not. Over here we have a poem that's illustrated by an art piece by two of the people we interviewed who were both students here at Cal State Fullerton. This is a poem called Time's Up, written by Earl Pedford in 1972. And a line art by Maurice Howard called done with pencils called The Children of Humility. That was done in 2012. In 1972, Maurice Howard was painting a mural called Black is Beautiful in the Student Union, next to the Black Student Union at the time. And before he was able to finish it, someone had carved KKK and the N-word into it, which immediately disgusted Earl Pedford, who was president of the Black Student Union, and Maurice Howard, who was creating it. Earl wrote a poem in response to it, and it's kind of a poem that resonates today in many ways, because it's about, you know, white superiority and this idea that some people, just on the basis of their skin, are considered less human or less American or less able to achieve equality or the same merits that everyone else should in our country. If we rely on the rhetoric of equality and anyone can become the president of the United States or anyone can make it here, we have to see more examples of that to prove it. We can't just have one or two and then say they all made it. This actually talks about the real issues and struggles, the day-to-day struggles African Americans face in terms of their own dignity. At Cal State Fullerton, for this to happen is particularly disgusting, because we're supposed to be a place of higher learning, but it's really representative of the whole nation as well. I don't want to just condemn Cal State Fullerton, it's really America at this time. If you go into the next part of the room, you'll see we have three computers set up to share the media from the research project, shares our massive timeline, which is not the one that's on the wall over here, which is heavily edited, but it actually shares all of our research, so people can challenge the research, look at where we got it from, see if we misinterpreted it, or build on it. We want this to be a conversation. So all of our interviews are available, as well as reflections and so much more. If you look at our massive timeline, I tried to situate it inside an orange grove because of Orange County and because of the issues of labor that underpin so many of these conversations. This timeline runs from 1960 to 1980, and you'll see that it highlights issues of celebration, as well as police encounters, issues of violence, activism, police abuse, and culture. So it has a lot of different material in it, but it is hardly comprehensive. It only gets at different pivots to start conversations, and some of the things may be shocking to viewers today, and some may not. But I was actually appalled by many of the things that I learned, and how historical memory doesn't include them when we have conversations about Fullerton history.
The most shocking thing I learned, definitely the whole incident with Officer Sasser, Daniel, and by extension Harlan's story about the murder of the Santa Ana police officer. I've lived in and around Orange County my entire life. I had no idea about any of that story surrounding it, which is another thing that inspired me to become part of this project, being a lifelong resident of this county and not knowing about any of this in detail. There was always a suspicion of something being under the surface, but nobody was ever really coming out and talking about these kinds of things going on in our community. We do have what's up here, but there's still so many other facts and events and people that are still yet to be discovered, still yet to be discussed. And so that is why we really want this exhibit not to completely embody what we have done here. We really encourage people to go check out our website, go look at any other stories related to this topic as well. Also very happy to include the stories of the people we interviewed here and these little oranges here as well for this exhibit. Again, very summarized, like every interview we have listed on this wall is at least an hour long on the website, so these short paragraphs can only do these people such justice. So again, it is just something we further encourage you to learn about because these were people in such a close-knit community at the time, not just surrounding Orange County, but CSUF as a whole as well.